certain that we stand in a declining hour. Certain that we stand in a defining hour. Halfway around the world, we are engaged in a great struggle in the skies and on the seas and sands. We know why we're there. We are Americans, part of something larger than ourselves. For two centuries, we've done the hard work of freedom, and tonight, we lead the world in facing down a threat to decency and humanity. What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind: peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law. Such is a world worthy of our struggle and worthy of our children's future. If it is possible, I want to continue to build a lasting basis for U.S.-Soviet cooperation for a more peaceful future for all mankind. The triumph of democratic ideas in Eastern Europe and Latin America, and the continuing struggle for freedom elsewhere, all around the world, all confirm the wisdom of our nation's founders. Tonight, we work to achieve another victory, a victory over tyranny and savage aggression.
order. A new world order, indeed. For the decency of the rest of the world. We're going to explore this and more with Aslan Moonbeam and myself, DJ Aldada, on the, right here on the screen for Peace Show. Aslan.
Yes, I am here, tuned in. So thanks, everybody, for joining us. Getting a double loop here. Hold on a second. That was an excellent, excellent opening song. Thanks for playing that. Very appropriate. And today's show, we're going to be talking about astrotheology and the New World Order. I'm still kind of shocked at times about people's responses when you say that phrase, New World Order, in public, or even the way it's represented in the media. Because what happens in the news recently? Tia Tequila, do you know who she is?
No.
She was a reality TV star or something, you know, a sexy little vixen. And she recently came out of hiding, I think, and has gone Nazi. And she's brandishing a swastika on her. One of the pictures she recently released is her sitting in this scantily, you know, hot shorts and a tie-off t-shirt or shirt with Auschwitz in the background. She's holding a gun in one hand. She's wearing a Nazi hat, and she's got a Nazi armband on the other hand, on her arm. And so there's an article on, what is it, Raw Stories. And in the article, it's just talking about what she's doing. And this is one of the ways, I guess, you can say the New World Order tries to convince the world that it doesn't exist. And to the general public, while in the background, controlling everything. But one of the ways you can spot propaganda is when you see the same break. You know, we have this idea. We grow up with the idea that there's this thing called the free press. And our image of how the media works is kind of like you watch the Superman movies and you see this young, aspiring writer, you know, going out there, beating the pavement for the hot story and then pitching it to the editor. And that's how stories are done. So it's really the other way around. The editors, the takers, take their orders from the owners, and take their orders from their owners, and so forth up the chain of command, and they come down and they basically train people to write fixed perspective. And so there's this phrase you hear over and over again, and I thought it's in this. Anybody can go, just if you Google or go to Raw Stories, there's a phrase in there, because I think she released a song and it has references to the New World Order. And in this article, there's an apparent reference to the New World Order, a popular boogeyman figure among conspiracy theorists. And so there you go again. It's like a diminishing something that is very real into the background and leading the general public to believe that it's not really there. What does this have to do with astrotheology? Absolutely everything, because the people who create religion basically create everything else as well. There's a very close-knit group of people controlling the finances, religion, and the military forces in the world, and a big part of that is entertainment and what I call propaganda. This would be a perfect example of propaganda, and that is sort of weaving in a perspective, a worldview through entertainment, arts and entertainment. Your general person is going to look at this article and say, wow, here's a hot chick going crazy. She likes Hitler. And there's some obvious contradictions. She says she's also converting to Judaism. And, you know, it's there was a real threat there, she would not be published. Huh. And so this is just another way. And if you want to find out more about the history of Nazism in America, beyond the book, you can go to our podcast or just our some previous pages and check that out. So that's extremeforpeace.net.
Not to mention the stealing of symbols as well that weren't necessarily negative.
Oh, right. The swastika is actually, if I got this right, I mean, it's an ancient symbol used by many cultures throughout time, as is the what is now referred to as the Star of David, but it's the hexagram is actually not, it wasn't created for that purpose. But, yeah, they adopt the thing, and I think they actually flipped it backwards. So if it was a pinwheel, it would actually be rotating clockwise or counterclockwise, and the original symbol would have been rotating in a clockwise position. So that's what a lot of people have done throughout the organization. We'll take a symbol, reverse the meaning. You see it at the first, when you first take a glance at it, resembles the original, but then it takes on, just like people do that with the cross. You know, the cross is supposed to symbolize Christ and goodness and all that, but then what happens when you take the cross and turn it upside down? Worshipping Satan, right?
Right.
And, yeah, we've seen that throughout the ages. And
the pitchfork.
Yeah.
The pitchfork was a symbol of the harvest amongst the pagans, and the Catholic Church came around. Said, this is the devil's tool now.
Kind of like today, what Monsanto is doing with farmers, demonizing them. Yeah, if you want to exercise your inner anarchist, plant a garden. See how well that goes. So today's show, we're going to be covering astrotheology. It's Christmas time again. And we got some very interesting things happening in the stars. Today's also December 16th, which has been throughout history. I guess you could say every day you can find war happening, important war events, probably if you go back throughout every single day in history. But for some reason, December 16th has popped up. It has some very interesting correlations. And so we're going to be talking about astrotheology and how the pervasive nature of religion has basically had an opposite effect of its intention and why. And, you know, I grew up in a Roman Catholic family in Pocatello, Idaho. That's where my seeds are sown. And I went through First Holy Communion. I had teachers in my family that taught catechism. And we grew up, believing or being taught Christ as Savior and was God's Son. And there was just, as I was growing up, there's just something wasn't right about it. I just didn't embrace the entire thing. And I pretty much, by the time I hit my teens, early teens, mid-teens, had pretty much rejected the whole notion of following a religious path. But I had told myself, maybe not even actively told myself, but I just accepted the fact that this dude named Jesus he lived a long time ago, and, 2,000 years ago, he was alive, walked the earth, did some cool stuff, he was a rebel, had a big following, rocked the world of many people, had an impact on the Holy Roman Empire, and then was killed for being a good guy, and then martyred. And then all of these supernatural stories that came up around him over the next 2,000 years just were adopted and created to give people something to hope for, basically. But I didn't buy into the supernatural aspects of it. Walking on water, healing the dead, rising from the dead. You know, those are just attributed to other things. So, for example, they said he fed the people. Well, maybe he was a cook. maybe he had a shop that made wine, and he had a restaurant, stuff like that, and he gave away food for free if you were hungry. You know, I attributed some of the stories and then the mythicizing of that around them. And I would say it wasn't until maybe 10 years ago-ish, I really started delving in and having discussions with people on whether he ever existed or not. And then that was just sort of an inkling that I had. And then just within the last few years, that was validated. And I discovered the work of the writer, scholar. She's actually my favorite living scholar today for a number of reasons. And her name is Acharia S. And so so a lot of what we're talking about today is going to be based on some books I've read of hers, I've purchased. She's got a great, her website is actually down at the moment. She might be getting hacked. She's definitely made some enemies out there because she could probably look back and say that the most bloodthirsty evil deeds, many of them that have ever been committed have been by, you know, good Christians. And they will kill you for their love. And I'm not saying everybody, but you can look back and just look at some of the wars throughout time that were done in the name of God. And that's the story that's fed to the common people. It's all about religion. If you have a politician that goes into office, you know, tons and tons and tons of time and effort is like, well, what's the religious, what does he believe in Jesus? You know, Obama, during his first presidential race, converted from Islam to Christianity and somehow found Christ. And that was just to appease the masses. But, you know, with all this conflict in Syria, Iran, you know, what the rulers put out over them, they cram it down our throats, is it's jihad, it's holy, the holy wars, it's all about whose God is better, which is really kind of ridiculous when you think about it. I mean, all these people are professing that their God is the best and it's about love, and they're going to kill anybody who disagrees with them. And it's just such an easy thing, and I'm reminded of a quote. I can't recall who said it. I'll go back and look for it. But if you can convince people of atrocities to believe in it, if you can convince people to believe in absurdities, you can convince them to commit atrocities. And religion throughout the ages, not just us in the Western world today, but going back thousands and thousands of years, Egypt, we see this. Pervasive theme among the gods, you know, and that is the born of a virgin, became a teacher, had 12 disciples, and yada yada, all these things. And you can go back, Horus in 3000 BC was just one of many. So astrotheology is the study of how religion is based on the celestial movements of the stars. So that's what we're going to talk about today. I'll be quoting from Acharia S. And there's also, if you want to do some more research on this, there's a writer, a speaker, researcher, also by the name of Jordan Maxwell. He's got some speeches on YouTube. Go back and read those. And I would recommend people that no matter what your position, to arm yourself with knowledge. If you're a believer, if you believe that Christ is the risen Savior and that he is the Son of God, then you absolutely must read every one of Acharya S.'s books. Because then you will be able to speak intelligently about the data that's out there. And it will do one of two things. It'll either shed new light on your beliefs and cause you to explore further what you believe in. So you know, or it'll reinforce what you already know. So if you're not a believer and you would like to know why and how Jesus was created and for what purposes, also read her book. Either way, and they're available in paperback as well as digital versions. And yeah, I'm actually traveling with all of her books right now and going through them. And so we've got some great music today as well, don't we?
Yes, we do.
Excellent, excellent. And why don't we go ahead and cut to a song, and then when we come back, we will get into some details and talk about some current events as well.
All right.
Oh,
back. That was Embracing the Sun by Thou Shalt Not.
Excellent, excellent. So, we'll get into a little bit of the date today, December 16th. There's been some interesting things going on, as well as this whole week. Did we talk about the Mandela thing last week much?
Yes, we did.
Yeah, I can't remember if we covered this, but he did not recently die. He died in June. That's when he was officially declared dead. And the cover story has been... Did you notice they never showed his body?
No.
Yeah, they never showed his body once. It was just, as far as I saw, everything was closed casket. And apparently his family has confirmed that he was brain dead in June. And that what they wanted, this is the cover story, this is what they're putting out. I don't buy it at all. They're saying that they had to keep him alive because there is a lawsuit pending about to the state or something, and if he was officially declared dead, they couldn't move forward with it. Something to do with power of attorney. That was their story. I think it was personally, they wanted him, this thing, there is a ritualistic ceremony going down. He was a member of the Knights of Malta, and he needed to be buried in a ritualistic manner. And for some reason, December, they wanted to get all these world leaders there at this time of year in Africa. We'll get into that later as more information comes up. Just wanted to put that out there. It's kind of interesting why they would delay his burial for so long. But Mandela officially claimed her dead in June and not buried or announced majorly until December. So keep that in mind. So back to the date. And this does have something to do with astrotheology, because throughout time, and I'm sure it's even going on today, is major events are scheduled to happen around religious holidays as well as the movement of the stars. And oftentimes there's a correlation between the two. And the correlation we're talking about today, well, we'll talk about December 16th, this is today's day. We'll also talk about the big correlation that's happening here this month, and the added variable of the Icon, Comet Icon, and its debris field. But what Christmas has been for millennia, for thousands of years, has been a celebration of the sun. The observation that on December 21st is when the sun, I believe it's the 21st, reaches its lowest point, and the days are the longest, or I'm sorry, the days are the shortest throughout the year. And then it sort of hovers for 3 days and then begins rising around Christmas. And it rises 1 degree on Christmas. And so we have this motif of the sun, which, if you put it in the context of the sun being all powerful, and imagine what the world was like 3,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago. You know, technology, understanding, it may not be exactly the same as it is today, but it was still, I think, very advanced. And far more advanced than the general public gives them credit for. And so we see that we imagine that the sun that we're looking at is also God, because without the sun, we would have nothing. And the sun, what would be the sun? It would be a smaller sun, or what we're going to talk about today is the sun being God. And how this mythology has become all-encompassing, I guess, in particularly in the Western world, and the invention, if you will, of Jesus. Now, why would they do this? Here's the question. You can go back and again, I would encourage everybody to read Acharia S's work, but there's something that, I would not consider myself an atheist. I don't believe that Jesus walked the earth as the Son of Man, but that's not to say that the words in the Bible itself, is completely without merit. You know, growing up, I'm really glad my parents, my mom, had Jesus in their lives. And it was something they could connect with. It was able to give a name to the spiritual aspect of existence, of reality. And no religion would work if there wasn't something real to it. And so you can just imagine, it's, 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, and there's a little kid, tugging on his dad's tunic, saying, "Hey, Dad, why does the sun rise? Why does this happen? Why do the stars shine? What's this? What's that?" And you'd have to come up with an explanation. And what is the best explanation we have are stories. And so I look at the Bible in many ways. It's not complete fiction, but it's also not the holy word of the divine, with select few individuals having the ability to access this information. I think that everybody, that's just the right of being human, we all have the ability to access the divine. And what religion does in many ways is it cuts us off from that. It tells us what it is and how we should interpret it. And then it points people like priests and deacons and popes and cardinals and elders to basically control those underneath with a dogma, with religious dogma. And so there's a great, great reference out there. We're gonna play a clip. If you can cue up the zeitgeist in the
video. Right.
We're gonna play about 10, 14 minutes maybe, of zeitgeist movie, in which they do a very good job on illustrating this. I'll have a link up on our blog page as well. But this work is... was based on the zeitgeist information is based on the work of Acharia S. And there is also a zeitgeist addendum, that companion, that you can acquire to go along with that. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead and cue that up, and then when we come back, we'll be able to discuss what it said.
This is the sun. As far back as 10,000 BC, history is abundant with carvings and writings reflecting people's respect and adoration for this object. And it is simple to understand why, as every morning the sun would rise, bringing vision, warmth, and security, saving man from the cold, blind, predator-filled darkness of night. Without it, the cultures understood, the crops would not grow, and life on the planet would not survive. These realities make the sun the most adored object of all time. Likewise, they were also very aware of the stars. The tracking of the stars allowed them to recognize and anticipate events which occurred over long periods of time, such as eclipses and full moons. They in turn cataloged celestial groups into what we know today as constellations. This is the cross of the zodiac, one of the oldest conceptual images in human history. It reflects the sun as it figuratively passes through the 12 major constellations over the course of the year. It also reflects the 12 months of the year, the four seasons, and the solstices and equinoxes. The term zodiac relates to the fact that constellations were anthropomorphized, or personified, as figures or animals. In other words, the early civilizations did not just follow the sun and stars, they personified them with elaborate myths involving their movements and relationships. The sun, with its life-giving and saving qualities, was personified as a representative of the unseen creator or God, God's sun, the light of the world, the savior of humankind. Likewise, the 12 constellations represented places of travel for God's sun, and were identified by names, usually representing elements of nature that happened during that period of time, For example, Aquarius, the water bearer, who brings the spring rains. This is Horus. He is the sun god of Egypt of around 3000 BC. He is the sun anthropomorphized, and his life is a series of allegorical myths involving the sun's movement in the sky. From the ancient hieroglyphics in Egypt, we know much about the solar messiah. For instance, Horus, being the sun or the light, had an enemy known as Set. And Set was the personification of the darkness or night. And, metaphorically speaking, every morning Horus would win the battle against Set, while in the evening Set would conquer Horus and send him into the underworld. It is important to note that dark versus light, or good versus evil, is one of the most ubiquitous mythological dualities ever known, and is still expressed on many levels to this day. Broadly speaking, the story of Horus is as follows. Horus was born on December 25th of the Virgin Isis Mary. His birth was accompanied by a star in the east, and upon his birth he was adored by three kings. At the age of 12, he was a prodigal child teacher. At the age of 30, he was baptized by a figure known as Anup, and thus began his ministry. Horus had 12 disciples he traveled about with, performing miracles such as healing the sick and walking on water. Horus was known by many gestural names such as the Truth, the Light, God's Anointed Son, the Good Shepherd, the Lamb of God, and many others. After being betrayed by Typhon, Horus was crucified, buried for 3 days, and thus resurrected. These attributes of Horus, whether original or not, seem to permeate in many cultures of the world, for many other gods are found to have the same general mythological structure. Attis of Phrygia, born of the Virgin Nana on December 25th, crucified, placed in a tomb, and after 3 days was resurrected. Krishna of India, born of the Virgin Devaki, with a star in the east signaling his coming. He performed miracles with his disciples, and upon his death, was resurrected. Dionysus of Greece, born of a virgin on December 25th, was a traveling teacher who performed miracles such as turning water into wine. He was referred to as the King of Kings, God's only begotten Son, the Alpha and Omega, and many others. And upon his death, he was resurrected. Mithra of Persia, born of a virgin on December 25th, he had 12 disciples and performed miracles, and upon his death was buried for 3 days and thus resurrected. He was also referred to as the Truth, the Light, and many others. Interestingly, the sacred day of worship of Mithra was Sunday. The fact of the matter is, there are numerous saviors from different periods from all over the world which subscribe to these general characteristics. The question remains, why these attributes? Why the virgin birth on December 25th? Why dead for 3 days in the inevitable resurrection? Why 12 disciples or followers? To find out, let's examine the most recent of the solar messiahs. Jesus Christ was born of the Virgin Mary on December 25th in Bethlehem. His birth was announced by a star in the east, which three kings or magi followed to locate and adorn a new savior. He was a child teacher at 12. At the age of 30, he was baptized by John the Baptist and thus began his ministry. Jesus had 12 disciples, which he traveled about with, performing miracles, such as healing the sick, walking on water, raising the dead. He was also known as the King of Kings, the Son of God, the Light of the World, the Alpha and Omega, the Lamb of God, and many, many others. After being betrayed by his disciple Judas and sold for 30 pieces of silver, he was crucified, placed in a tomb, and after 3 days was resurrected and ascended into heaven. First of all, the birth sequence is completely astrological. The star in the east is Sirius, the brightest star in the night sky, which, on December 24th, aligns with the three brightest stars in Orion's belt. These three bright stars in Orion's belt are called today what they were called in ancient times, the Three Kings. And the three kings and the brightest star, Sirius, all point to the place of the sunrise on December 25th. This is why the three kings follow the star in the east, in order to locate the sunrise, the birth of the sun. The Virgin Mary is the constellation Virgo, also known as Virgo the Virgin. Virgo in Latin means virgin. Virgo is also referred to as the house of bread. and the representation of Virgo is a virgin holding a sheaf of wheat. This house of bread and its symbol of wheat represents August and September, the time of harvest. In turn, Bethlehem, in fact, literally translates to house of bread. Bethlehem is thus a reference to the constellation Virgo, a place in the sky, not on earth. There's another very interesting phenomenon that occurs around December 25th, or the winter solstice. From the summer solstice to the winter solstice, the days become shorter and colder. And from the perspective of the northern hemisphere, the sun appears to move south and get smaller and more scarce. The shortening of the days and the expiration of the crops when approaching the winter solstice symbolize the process of death to the ancients. It was the death of the sun. And by December 22nd, the sun's demise was fully realized. But the sun, having moved south continually for 6 months, makes it to its lowest point in the sky. Here a curious thing occurs. The sun stops moving south, at least perceivably, for 3 days. And during this 3-day pause, the sun resides in the vicinity of the Southern Cross, or Crux, constellation. And after this time, on December 25th, the sun moves 1 degree, this time north, foreshadowing longer days, warmth, and spring. And thus it was said, the sun died on the cross, was dead for 3 days, only to be resurrected or born again. This is why Jesus and numerous other sun gods share the crucifixion, 3-day death, and resurrection concept. It is the sun's transition period before it shifts its direction back into the northern hemisphere, bringing spring and thus salvation. However, they did not celebrate the resurrection of the sun until the spring equinox, or Easter. This is because at the spring equinox, the sun officially overpowers the evil darkness, as daytime thereafter becomes longer in duration than the night, and the revitalizing conditions of spring emerge. Now, probably the most obvious of all the astrological symbolism around Jesus regards the 12 disciples. They are simply the 12 constellations of the zodiac, which Jesus, being the sun, travels about with. In fact, the number 12 is replete throughout the Bible. Coming back to the cross of the zodiac, the figurative life of the sun, this was not just an artistic expression or tool to track the sun's movement. It was also a pagan spiritual symbol, the shorthand of which looked like this. This is not a symbol of Christianity. It is a pagan adaptation of the cross of the zodiac. This is why Jesus in early occult art is always shown with his head on the cross, for Jesus is the Son of God, the light of the world, the risen Savior, who will come again, as it does every morning, the glory of God, who defends against the works of darkness, as he is born again every morning, and can be seen coming in the clouds, up in heaven, with his crown of thorns, or sun rays. Now, of the many astrological, astronomical metaphors in the Bible, one of the most important has to do with the ages. Throughout the scriptures, there are numerous references to the age. In order to understand this, we need to be familiar with a phenomenon known as the precession of the equinoxes. The ancient Egyptians, along with cultures long before them, recognized that approximately every 2150 years, the sunrise in the morning of the spring equinox would occur in a different sign of the zodiac. This has to do with a slow, angular wobble that the Earth maintains as it rotates on its axis. It is called a precession because the constellations go backwards rather than through the normal yearly cycle. The amount of time it takes for the precession to go through all 12 signs is roughly 25,765 years. This is also called the Great Year. And ancient societies were very aware of this, and they referred to each 2150-year period as an age. From 4300 BC to 2150 BC, it was the age of Horus, the bull. From 2150 BC to 1 AD, it was the age of Aries, the ram. And from 1 AD to 2150 AD, it is the age of Pisces, the age we are still in to this day. And in and around 2150, we will enter the new age, the age of Aquarius. Now, the Bible reflects, broadly speaking, a symbolic movement through three ages while foreshadowing a fourth. In the Old Testament, when Moses comes down Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments, he is very upset to see his people worshiping a golden bull calf. In fact, he shattered the stone tablets and instructed his people to kill each other in order to purify themselves. Most biblical scholars will attribute this anger to the fact that the Israelites were worshiping a false idol or something to that effect. The reality is, the golden bull is Taurus, the bull, and Moses represents the new age of Aries the ram. This is why Jews even today still blow the ram's horn. Moses represents the new age of Aries, and upon the new age, everyone must shed the old age. Other deities mark these transitions as well, such as Mithra, a pre-Christian god who kills the bull in the same symbology. Now Jesus is the figure who ushers in the age following Aries, the age of Pisces, or the two fish. Fish symbolism is very abundant in the New Testament. Jesus feeds 5,000 people with bread and two fish. When he begins his ministry walking along Galilee, he befriends two fishermen who follow him. And I think we have all seen the Jesus fish on the back of people's cars. Little do they know what it actually means. It is a pagan astrological symbolism for the sun's kingdom during the age of Pisces. Also, Jesus' assumed birth date is essentially the start of this age. At Luke 22:10, when Jesus is asked by his disciples where the last Passover would be, Jesus replies, "Behold, when ye are entered into the city, there shall be a man."
From hibernation. I love him, I love him, I love him, I love him.
She loves him, she loves
him. This time,
she loves him, she loves him.
I'm gonna keep it to myself.
She loves him, she loves him, she loves him.
This time.
Change. First off, I'd have no guns, just hand-to-hand combat. Only the strong survive like cavemen. I like that. If I was God, the sun would blink from time to time and black out. I'd introduce a newest spot, I'd put Eazy-E back out. I'd fucking ride up in the sky, up on a cloud, floating around both brand wishes and throwing lightning bolts down. If I was God, I'd show up and host Saturday Night Live just to freak him out and let everybody know I'm alive. If I was God, I'd explode every crooked preacher's head, right? Then when he's screaming and preaching, face all red. If I was God, I'd go and try to whip the devil's ass, but it probably ain't that easy, and I'd probably learn it fast. If I was God, I'd ride a dragon down to earth, pull Bin Laden out the sand and fucking kill him myself. If I was God, I'd turn pop music upside down. We'd have the top 40, let's be top 40 underground. I'd watch Twisted take home 7 Grammys or more. I'd see Boondocks, not front page of the source, and somehow I'd be about to marry Beyonce, telling the paparazzi,
oh, y'all get the fuck out of
here. If I was God, I'd grow my face hair as long like Moses. Hit the club in an iced out halo and see where the hose is. I'd cork all the world's volcanoes and let this bitch blow, and then rewrite the timeline so that it never happened. So I do it again and again and again and again and again. Every time I needed to express my anger within, I'd fly above the cities of giants with searchlight eyes. I'd let you motherfuckers know I'm watching, ready to energize. I got them lightning bolts. I'd turn the prisons into country clubs, make a lot more hotties be attracted to scrubs. If I was God, every now and then it'd rain dynamite just to keep you on your toes, make sure you got your shit tight. I'd bring your dinosaurs back just when nobody expects it. Send your prayers to each other, see if you're gonna reject it. I'd give everybody 3 rewinds for shit they might have passed up. I'd cure the sick and diseased and let the crippled get their ass up. I'd make it rain money everywhere that it's needed. Crooked cops would get their ass beaten, shit would get even. I do a lot of shit different, but I don't know shit. I'm so happy that I ain't here, my head about to spit. I'll fucking make it rain indoors, I know that much. I take a photo of me with the devil in the camo clutch and put it on all the TVs for 24 hours. Make giant meteors pass by the earth within a couple yards. Shit, if I was God, I'd walk up on the city like King Kong. Kneel down in the street and fucking peep in your home. If I was God, jealousy would be easily detected. Their faces would turn that of a demon every time they felt it. Fucking earthquake. I'll shake this bitch dramatically. I pick the earth up, shaking pepper, my spaghetti with trees. Holy shit, y'all. What the fuck would I do if I was God? Man, fuck, what the fuck should I do? I give all the hungry and needy pieces and steak and cook it all over the flames of hell if that's what it takes. I drop a couple new animals every fucking month or so and send a few tornadoes through where they don't normally go. I'd not only walk on water for you, I'd hammer sliding buggy. They snap my fingers and give all the little kids each a cookie. I send snowstorms to the desert, heat strokes to the Arctic. 3 times a year visits with your dearly departed. I put about 10,000 real Jason Voorhees out there just to add a fresh element of fear in the air. I throw angel picnics and parties
We get drunk and come down to earth. Probably picking fucking fights up in the church. I'd have a stretch limo so long the front's already there. And I ain't even left yet. Fago legs everywhere. I jog inside the earth and make it spin like a hamster wheel. I'd have aliens come and try and make us their meal. But that's exactly why they gave the job to somebody else. Or is there a day? Fuck it. Figure it yourself, cause I ain't got a clue in hell. Man, I'm probably fucking going to hell. Fuck you, man, what? I'm going to hell.
The insane clown posse, If I Were God. And just before that, we had Bjork, Pagan Poetry.
Very good, very good.
And If You're God, Aslan, what had happened?
What's that?
If you were God, what would you do?
Oh, that's such an unfair question. The first thing I would do is abolish all religion.
Would you bring back the dinosaurs? Like the clown posse message?
No, I think I would want to, I would establish schools that were free to attend, and I would teach people about how the universe works. And, you know, much of, that's a good question, because I think a big part of the problem in the world is, you know, not that God created man in his image, but rather man created God in his image, and is continuously striving to be that God. People want to be worshipped, they want to be adored, and it's pride and ego, you know? And I think that's one of the big reasons why it's so difficult to have rational conversations with people about religion, particularly if you come up, for example, if you're sitting around a group of people and some of them believe in Jesus, they're Christians, they go to church, they grew up their whole lives, and you bring up the concept, I don't think Jesus ever existed as a historical figure, and there's a lot of proof to show that, you know. Most people can't have a rational conversation about that. What they do is they get emotional, and this is the reason why. It's because they grew up with this information. That means that if this is such a radical misinformation campaign that it's global in scope that affects millions, that means subconsciously they're going to think there's something seriously wrong with the world, or there's something seriously wrong with this person. And so they, rather than having a conversation about the relevance of this or why it happened or how it happened, they will go directly onto the offensive and the attack, you know, and they're completely incapable of having a rational conversation. And I think in many ways we have gone past the age of reason. We are, you know, people, this is one of the ways that Nazism came into power. And Hitler even said it himself, you know, forget reason. You know, reason doesn't have any place here. What, you know, emotions are what matters. You know, how do you feel? And that's what we see trickled down to us in entertainment and even scientific and religious dogma will throw reason out the window and just go with your gut, go with what you think is right. And the Jesus lie is an easy one to absorb because you want to believe there's something greater than yourself. And the big question is, why do you see this sort of boilerplate application of religion throughout all time, not just now? But I think in the year 3000, they're going to look back at us and say, they're going to put Jesus in the same category as Horus, Zeus, and Apollo, you know? And if you had asked a Greek or Roman, you know, about their god back during their time, they would believe it fervently that they lived in the sky, they lived in the stars. And they were down there looking and interacting with humans, and for them that was actually true. And I think that's very much the way it is with Jesus today. But it's had such a pervasive effect on our livelihood and just our day-to-day life. So, for example, the god Horus, which was also, born of a virgin on December 25th, and killed, resurrected, teacher, 12 followers, yada, yada, yada. We heard that talk in the Zeitgeist. Oh, by the way, that full clip was about 30 minutes long, and we'll have the link to that on our blog. And so I would suggest everybody actually watch the whole movie if you can. There's three movies. Watch them all. They're pretty good. I don't agree with absolutely everything they put in, but very, very educational. But, the myth about Horus was that he woke up in the morning. He took 12 steps across the sky, which was at the peak 12 hours, and that's where we get the word hours from. It was Horus. He walked across the sky, and then when you can see him, where did the sun rise? Was the sun rises at the horizon. Horus has risen, horizon. Then at night he battles with Set. And that is where we get sunset, the sunset. He battles with the god Set. Set was what brings the night, and that, there's this pervasive dualistic nature of the universe, good, bad, up, down, left, right, day, night, black, white. And the sun is up and it brings all things good and warm and nurtures. And then when it sunset, then the evil comes out, the bad stuff, darkness comes out at night. And so these religion, theosophical themes, they're pervasive throughout our culture, even in areas that don't necessarily have anything to do with religion, or we don't think we do. And a big part, part of what we're talking about is NWO, New World Order. And, you even brought up something yesterday in the conversation that we talked about on the show, and that was, the importance of dates. Not in the sense that you can project it, but I think things are actually planned on a specific date. And today is December 16th, but one that I started looking into a while ago was the date September 11th. If that was a calculated date, obviously somebody planned the attack on the World Trade Center, was there an importance to that date? And that was going to go 911, 911, that's our emergency number. 1983 on September 11th, it was put into play. And I looked back and found out, the American Revolution actually began on September 11th, 1776. The Pentagon, our war, central war machine for global war, is headquartered, broke ground on September 11th of 1941, shortly before Pearl Harbor in World War II. And then, also, what happened in 1991, was George Bush's famous New World Order speech, in which and this was a State of the Union address, in which he basically, said we're going for the New World Order. And so anybody that hears the word New World Order and gives you the big eye roll where they push it, has got their head planted firmly right up their own ass. Actually, I call it sandbags. These people that they refuse to look at the world around them. They bury us. They dig a hole of media. They dig a hole of pleasure, of fun, of self-absorbed happiness. Stick their head in it, and as long as they can control that little hole, then they're fine with it. Fuck the rest of the world, and they are just going to go through life. But in that position, you leave yourself open. Personally, I think we're at a crux right now, time-wise. There's some big things coming up on the horizon with the four blood moons beginning, and these are the last four blood moons, and that's going to begin on April of 2014. So there's going to be some heavy stuff coming out, and I do believe that beginning April 14th, we're going to see a two-year global war going on, in which when we emerge out of this, the New World Order will have been established. There will be a global government, a global currency. Most people in America will have either an implanted chip inside their body, or they will be carrying a national, international ID card that is also chips. It will be required to carry with you at all times. We'll see a police state in the United States. We already have it, actually. Checkpoints everywhere where you'll have to be required to have this card with you. But the funny thing is that they are not going to put out and say, okay, you have to do this, you have to do this. They will create emergencies, create chaos, and out of the order, people will be begging for it. Please let me have this. Religion, again, back to the religion, this is one of the ways they will usher religion throughout time, is not to bring people, organized religion, I should say, is not to bring people, and I'm not talking at the lower levels, independent churches, stuff like that, but it's at the much higher level, it's not to bring enlightenment or awareness, it's to control people and control the masses. And always has been, always will be. But the reason why it works is because we are a tribal people. We desire to be part of groups, and with that, we die. I know this for a fact. I'm personally not a part of any group, really, that I would say at all. And I can feel the disconnect based on, the groups I have been part of in the past. And it's something we as humans require. We need that. And there is a spiritual nature to our existence. It has nothing to do with God, how the general, nothing to do with the guy in the cloud casting judgment on us and sending us to hell if we don't follow him. That's not the God. I actually refer to God as the governing operational dynamic, how the universe works, and how you can, there is a scientifically proven phenomenon in the world, in the universe, that proves that the power of faith and belief is a real thing. And it is the cornerstone of our pharmaceutical industry, and it's called the placebo effect. And that's just one instance that where we can see the power of faith and belief has a very real effect on the world and our own body. And if it affects that, it also has the ability to affect other things as well. So the reason why the religion works and people will follow it is because they created this dogma, these stories, this myth that is reinforced in some ways by personal experience. And that's why it works. But it is pervasive throughout our society. And you can say the people that actually are implementing the New World Order, that are based in Europe. They control our money system, the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve banks are all over the world, not just the United States. And they have been working on these plans for hundreds of years, you know, hundreds of years, on implementing this global government under their totalitarian control. And one of the ways they tell us the world is one way, but it's really something else. Like, for example, I heard a great quote on the radio, I saw it online today by a woman, called, I think she called herself the libertarian girl, and she asked the questions like, how can we claim to both be the country of freedom, but also have the highest incarceration rate of any country in the world? And again, so there's an example of telling us things are one way and it's really another. But back to the astrotheology, you know, much of what we find in our society that we just take for granted all has its foundation in the occult. And the occult, you know, if you just the general person, if you ask them what the occult is, they're gonna go, oh, it's voodoo, witchcraft, and vampires and things like that. You know, it's the super abnormal, paranormal things that aren't really real. People just imagine them to be real, or science fiction. You think that would be fair, the people's version of the occult is? Sergio?
Yeah, this version of what?
The occult, when people hear the word occult, they automatically equate it to devil worshiping and, you know, vampires and things that aren't really real. And it's kind of hokey stuff in the background happening. And I think that's generally what people think of it. But the real meaning of the cult is hidden, the hidden knowledge. And so what the NWO people, some people call them the Illuminati, but you can just call them our rulers, you know, the ruling class. They have access to the information. They know how it works. They use it all into their favor, and they basically twist it. And in many ways, they take facts and turn them into myths, and then they take myths and turn those into facts, and feed the public a story, you know, a fable. And like, this is what it is. And oftentimes there's some element of truth in there, which causes lots of confusion, you know, among the people. But I think that, you know, even at the highest levels of the church, the Catholic Church, they know for a fact that Jesus never walked the earth, and that it is, in their mind, a noble lie. And it's the lie you tell the public, the people, because it's in their own best interest. And many people believe that, but many other people believe that it's not in their best interest, and that that's just what you tell them to keep control, to stay in control. And but when you delve into it, you'll come across again and again very interesting tidbits of information. And when you start putting all these tidbits of information together, you think, wait a minute, this can't be an accident. You know, so something that you'll come across, I've come across this, is where did the word Hollywood come from, do you know?
No.
I'd wonder that many times. You know, it's Hollywood. Was it after a forest or something? I had no idea until I really started looking into this stuff. And Hollywood is one of the ways they create our worldview in many ways. It's a form of social media control in which they tell you how you should perceive world events, and in the form of stories. And here's, I mentioned this last week, and in Nazi Germany, when they were putting out the propaganda against Jewish people, you know, they created two movies. One was a documentary demonizing the Jews, and the other was a fictional story that demonized the Jews in a way, but in an entertaining manner. The documentary was a complete flop, And the story was a complete success. It was huge. And they learned they could do more to storytelling than telling people facts. And so that's what we see, not just in movies, but television shows. They create the paradigm for which we interpret real-world events. So that's why you see so many television shows with FBI agents out there conquering terrorism. What do real-life FBI agents do? They set up terror. there's a big contrast between reality and what we perceive to be reality, but it is subtle enough to where it's easy to dismiss and just accept the social norms that were given. And so history is rewritten over and over again. Just here's a great example is, you know, shortly after Osama bin Laden was supposedly killed, we see this movie come out. All the best directors were hired, the best writers, the best actors, very well executed. It was an entertaining movie to watch. It was very high drama, but that's the story they want us to believe. And so when we see these stories out there, you know, we want to believe that. And there's this unstated, when you see a movie on a historical event, there's sort of this unstated perception that it's the duty of the filmmakers. What they're trying to do is recreate what actually happened. You know, because we have these things called documentaries, but in many ways, they're not creating what actually happened. They're creating what they want the people to think happened to reinforce the storyline. And so looking into that, something I found interesting was going back to the Druids who, in their cult practices, they use the thing called a magic wand. You see them in, you know, it's the magician's wand. They're still used today. And the magician's wand was made from the tree of a holly tree. So it was Hollywood. That's where the name comes from. And why did they pick that name? Because that's what Hollywood is. It's creating magic. And out of magic, it creates reality. Out of reality, that's where our perception comes from. That's our worldview. And it doesn't even have to, when you really think about how big the world is and how many people are living daily their lives, how many people do you come in contact with on a daily basis? It's pretty staggering that it all works, that all just sort of comes together and works. But our own personal view is very, very limited. It doesn't matter how much experience is, if you compare the individual's personal experience to the experience of the whole, it's very myopic, very small. But we have, because of media, we have access to this big world view. We can picture in our mind. If you've never been to Paris, you know what the Eiffel Tower looks like. If you've never been to Washington, D.C., you've seen pictures. You can put in your mind what the White House looks like, what the Oval Office looks like. If you've never been to prison, you've seen enough of them on television to know what it looks like. And that's the power of media. And so when we look at astrotheology and religion in general, what we see is a form of media. You know, the word propaganda came out of the churches. What they did is they were propagating the word of God. And then you add in propagate with an agenda, it's propagation. I'm sorry, propaganda. And so all propaganda is media that is skewed to, I guess you could say, either mislead or create in favor, a favorable attitude towards whatever source is driving the agenda. So, like, there isn't anything that's not propaganda. You look at the media, you look at what you read in the New York Times, what you see on television, and you see the same story repeated over and over and over again, same talking point, same word. I tell you, again, I'll say this again, if you want to see the most awe-inspiring form of propaganda ever created by man, I think, is just watch CNN, you know. It's hypnotic, very well produced generally, but, you know, they CNN, Fox, they've all been accused of showing that they invent the news. They will create it to continue their own worldview and to create a worldview that is, I'm telling you, if people understood what was going on in the world, they would drop everything and come together, and there would be a revolution, not just in America, but all over the world, against the ruling classes, to create a system that makes sense for everybody and not just a few. Because there are atrocities going on right now, today, in our own backyard, that most good people would say they would not stand for if it was happening to them or their family, but they're just completely unaware of it. And it's done very calculated, very intelligently, and through a combination of politics, religion, economics. And we saw this happen. You know, World War II was an experiment. And it was an experiment that was very successful. And the Nazis did not lose the war. Don't think that. They're still very much in charge. And I would say they really took over America in 1913. And you can go back to some of our earlier podcasts and see about that, or learn more about that. But let's go ahead and play a couple songs. And then when we come back, we're going to talk about today's date, December 16th.
Okay.
Right.
Cool.
Oh, 13th, 2013. We've been talking about December 16th and the funeral of Mandela and things like that. I want to look at this date back in history, both geologically and from the events of the governments of this world. But in 1575, we had an 8.5 down in Chile, guys. That a lot of people got hurt. Again, December 16th, 1575, caused the rivers to flow both ways. This date, 1707, the last eruption of one of the greatest mountains in the world, Fiji, said that an 8.7 quake, it severely damaged the Osaka, and it said it created enough seismic activity to compress the magma chamber 20 kilometers deep in the inactive, like it is now, inactive Mount Fuji. says, due to the compression, basaltic lava rose from the bottom to the higher dacitic magma chamber. That's when it blew. Back to the government. December 16th, 1773. The destruction of the tea in Boston, the Boston Tea Party, nonviolent political protest by the Sons of Liberty. Pay attention. Let's move forward. Earthquake. Beijing, December 17th, 7.8. They classify it, but Japan, the historians say it was an 8.5. 73,000 people were killed. It was called the Great Haiyan Earthquake. A landslide buried the village of Sujaya. More than 30,000 people were killed in that county. Nearly all the houses were collapsed. Now back to the government, because this Nazi government, deep into the occult, December 16th, Himmler ordered the Roman Centa, still living in Germany, to Auschwitz, guys. They burned them. And this was the gypsies and anybody that was even thought to be mixed with the gypsies throughout the Balkans. They were, on that date, sent to Auschwitz to burn. Another December 16th this year, they say, is the true end of the Mayan calendar. It says a time of total collapse, time of judgment of God, epidemics, plagues, and famine, the loss of the prophets and the wise men. That's what the end of that is. Now, guys, the Illuminati governments of this world can play some tricks, and this is one of their first great media mind control experiments. December 16th, 1997. In prime time that night, they broadcast 20 minutes of a cartoon, and they had flashing strobe lights in it at 12 hertz. That's your alpha and beta area, the frequency of your brain, to where that's your prayer and meditative state. Now, it caused blurred vision, headaches, dizziness, nausea. They had to go to the hospital. Japan's fire defense agency reported 685 viewers were taken to hospitals. 12,000 children who did not get sent to the hospital reported symptoms of illness. They said they more closely resemble mass hysteria than a grand seizure, a grammar seizure. Now, they knew what was going to happen. And this program that they used with this blinking lights, it was a popular cartoon. Well, once it happened, they had to shut it down for a few months, guys. It totally altered the consciousness of these children. 12,000. Do you understand what they did? Listen, this 8 to 12 cycles has been known for millennium what it will do and what it does. Now, what did the American media do when they saw this back in 77? They said, oh, it's okay. It won't hurt American children. They're not susceptible to this light sensitivity, or what they call photosensitive seizures, guys. But again, this was a move to test media control through mass hysteria. And this is about the program. They call it the Electric Soldier Paragon, December 6, 1997. Don't think this won't happen. Of course, USA Today has told the Americans that their children aren't likely to suffer seizures provoked by TV cartoons. Of course, everything's fine. Go back to sleep. Here, they try to blame it on photosensitive epileptic seizures. But all of those children, again, never had it again. It was an experiment. I wonder what it did to them. Guys, while we're in December the 25th, Christmas, known as Nativity of the Sun, the date of Tammuz, the sun, the reincarnation of the sun god. Yule used to be December 21st, Catholic Church moved to the 25th. Even the name Christmas is pagan. Christa, meaning Christ, Mass, and the pagan is for a mass funeral for the death. They celebrate the death of Christ. The deeper meaning lies in the mention of Christ without specifying Jesus, saying it is the death of Christ, the rise of their Antichrist, the rise of their Antichrist. Are you listening? Now, you look back in history, the Puritan community would not celebrate Christmas on this day. They found it was a pagan and it was idolatry. But until the U.S. government in 1870, about the time they took the books of Enoch and all, were getting ready to do that, they declared it a federal holiday. but it is a celebration of the pagans coming Antichrist, who will deal, they think, a blow to Jesus Christ. Sorry, my friends, we know who wins that last battle. But this is, we went from God and the earth to the governments of this world. The end times are approaching soon. Heads up.
Oh, I just love that guy's voice. So that was a clip from BP Earthwatch. If you go to bpearthwatch.com, there's some great links and stuff. But here's an example of this guy. I think his name is Jesse. He's a Christian. Puts out a lot of good information on Comet Einstein. But even though we have differing opinions on the nature of religion, I think what brings it together and why I follow his postings is because of the accuracy and his perspective is very good. Even though I don't agree with some of them philosophically, the facts are still there. So he covered some information on dates. I got a couple more to throw out at you. 1431, the Hundred Years' War began. 1598, 7 years' war. He covered Mount Fuji, but here's an important one. 1773, one of the most famous false flag attacks in the history of the United States occurred on this date in Boston. And that is where 50 people-ish dressed up as Indians and initiated what we now know as the Boston Tea Party. So happy birthday to Boston Tea Party. And 1914, World War One, major attack from Germany on Britain. 1915, Einstein's theory of relativity was published. That's something great we can all celebrate. There have been some nuclear tests going on in various states, various years, in the Pacific Ocean and in the desert on this date. In 1991, the Zionist-controlled United Nations declared Zionism not racist. That's interesting. Took all that time. In 1944, the Battle of the Bulge, and just 6 years later, an emergency was declared, and what we now know as the Korean War began, and that was in 1950. So it's an interesting date. So looking at this, I was just like, I went to bed last night, but I was thinking, I wonder what interesting thing is going to happen today. And I don't have the details on it, but I'm going to go back after we get off the air and do some research. But apparently there have been some major explosives discovered at Harvard University, and buildings are being evacuated as we speak. I don't know if they found anything yet. I don't know if they were actually bombs or not. The word I just heard was explosives were discovered in buildings that shouldn't be there. So that was interesting. And again, whether you believe in numerology or not, or whether you believe in astrotheology or any of this stuff, religion, it doesn't matter what you believe or think. It really doesn't, because your belief has very little to do with reality. You can believe forever that the earth is really flat and the sun rotates around us, but that does not alter the nature of reality. And, I think that's what I've been on a lifelong quest for the truth. And I have a scientific background, engineering background, and there is a such thing as cause and effect. And so when you see effects that are attributed to a cause that are just simply not there. But sometimes it seems apparent that it's obvious that it happens. And so oftentimes you just embrace whatever is convenient and then move on to the next thing. But this is how rituals occur. So for example, 500 years ago, some guys milking his goat, and then he discovers when he milks his goat and the goat's facing the barn, it tastes better. So he's always going to milk the goat with the goat facing the barn. And then if he does that for 7 days in a row, if he gets good milk 7 days in a row, it rains. And then they create these rituals over that. And that's one of the way myths develop. And So very, very, very interesting things going on in the world. And just a few minutes left. I do have another clip I want to play from. Can you pull the other one up?
Yeah.
From the Australian girl. What is her name? I'll pull this up. This is somebody out there I can follow on YouTube. We've got some good observations, and I like the sound of her voice. She's got a nice accent too. But she's got some very good coverage of world events from her perspective, and she's got some good insight into the ether. She often talks about the ether, and we discussed that as well, what I call the ether sphere. And we'll post all these links on our website. I want to thank everybody for joining us. Keep an eye on out. If you like what we have to say, and you think other people should hear this message, go to screamforpeace.net, enter your email address. You'll just get notified when our podcasts are published. And when it does so, you can share them with whoever you like. And we do appreciate your listening. And we're in the process, actually. We'll see how this goes, but I think we might have a YouTube channel pretty soon. We're going to be converting our podcast to video, so you can listen on YouTube. We'll hopefully reach a larger audience. Isn't that happening?
Yeah, it is. Ready?
Okay, so we're going to just play a few minutes of this. I think about 10 minutes long, and then probably end up with a song. So thanks to everybody for listening to us. Let's go ahead and cut back one more time, and I'll make some comments about her comments.
Okay.
Interesting, because this involves Venus, Earth, the Sun, and Orion, and also the Maya. Now, I pay attention to anything with Venus, because Venus was very important to the Maya, and I know the Maya were absolutely first-class astronomers and would not have paid attention to Venus unless they knew how important it was. Now, they revered Venus as much as they revered the sun. I mean, when you look at all of the other cultures and you see how they deified the sun and how they regarded the sun, well, imagine the Maya did the same thing with not only the sun, but Venus. And this is because they knew Venus was a timekeeper. And the Maya say Venus was a timekeeper. And this is because Venus brought in the ages. You know, Venus is the timekeeper of the eons, of the cycle, of the ages. And Venus brings in the, you know, new cycles of consciousness as we experience the, you know, creator's influence more profoundly than at other times. So there are bigger cycles above us in the macrocosm. And due to those cycles above us, we experience an illumination of light that is experienced on the physical plane and illuminates in turn our divinity and our potential. And so this is what was known as the Golden Age. And so you can imagine such an important time on Earth would be remembered by every culture, and this is why it's pretty much a no-brainer that all of the mythology and all of the information is about what occurs, this illumination, you know, this return of the divine ones who are the firstborn of the creator, and through their illumination you know, the collective illuminates and we experience a time of higher consciousness on the physical plane. And so though I don't really like focusing on dates, because I do believe that dates really are something where we're trying to define the undefinable, because we always have to account for a chaos factor, so there can never be any real surety in some things. In others, there is. I mean, the sun will always rise, the moon will always orbit the sun, the earth, and, you know, we will always orbit the sun. Some things are just cycles. You know, this is where I imagine Ezekiel's wheel. It's just the cycle within the cycle. And you can't change that. But you can change when this event, these events occur as determined by our consciousness, because we do have somewhat of an effect back to, reflecting back to the higher consciousness. So we do have an influence in a way on the timing of events. And there are a few hermetic drawings where you actually see God's hand, and he is playing like an instrument where he can change the tune of the instrument. And so this is why, dependent upon events playing out in time frames on the physical, the ethereal responds and vice versa. So I hope I understand that kind of influence of the Creator that you can never quite determine. So even though some events you won't ever change, there are ways to influence our destiny in the way events are timed consciously. So I hope I've explained that. And so basically, that's why I really don't focus on dates, though I do find that dates are important indicators of shifts. And so even if you don't see something in the physical play out in response to that date, you still understand that that date was bringing in another important part of the cycle as it continues to evolve. Because, you know, imagine that we're like changing gears all the time, okay? And it's also done in like a Fibonacci sequence. And this is why, as we move towards the zero point in all of this, back to source, we feel that time is speeding up. And that's because it actually is, in regards to following the Fibonacci sequence, basically, along those lines, you know, it would be speeding up and doubling in itself. And so this is why events seem to play out faster and faster, because, as I said, cause and effect start to accelerate. So the intervals in between cause and effect become smaller, which makes you always feel that there is a lot of activity going on, and that therefore makes you feel overwhelmed, you know. And this is why a lot of people feel that things are so busy now, life's so busy, you know, everyone's so busy. And this is because of this acceleration of consciousness that we're feeling in relation to the acceleration of time. And, you know, you've got to understand that time in the physical, in the analog, is attached to us in the physical. So it is only relaying to us what we are presently experiencing. It's not really relaying ethereal time, okay? It's locked into the matrix. So you won't see time really change by the clock. It will just be in the way that you are feeling, you know, just in your conscious awareness of events around you and how it seems that they transpire very quickly before you look at the clock, and it seems like you haven't really done a lot, you know, or, and it seems to be so late. So this is where we're feeling that time is speeding up, but we can't really account for it because we're expecting to see it in the physical play out on our clocks. So you see, you've really got to start moving into the ethereal. I probably am talking another language to a lot of people. And so, you know, this is why I can't really stop relaying information and wait for other people to catch up, you know. So I'm just hoping that when you're listening to this information, you will just in time be able to understand how I'm trying to relay it, you know, and what I'm trying to explain to you in relation to what we're experiencing at the moment. I mean, if you're one of those people that just think we're experiencing nothing and reality is just completely normal and you can't feel any shifts of energy, there's nothing around you that you are finding the least bit interesting or amazing, or, you know, something to even that makes you feel that there's something not quite right going on, or that you can't quite explain, then seriously, you're like dead inside, you know. You're like, seriously, you just may as well just hook back into the matrix, you know, plug back into the machine. It'd be more humane for you to go out that way, plugged back into the machine, than kind of go out half awake. So, you know, those, however, that are open-minded and are seeking knowledge and understanding of who they are and what is occurring in these times, well, we're always looking for indicators to confirm what we're actually feeling, because we know that we're not going crazy, because we can see that others are confirming in what we're feeling, as well as there are other indicators confirming for us.
Yeah, that was good. I like that. And we're gonna.
Well, I definitely know what I'm feeling, but I could listen to her hours on end. I'd imagine her to be an Australian redhead.
No, I think she's got blonde hair.
Oh, blonde.
Blonde hair. But I can't look at you. But I, her channel is, I think it's ThyAlwaysSeek, ThyAlwaysSeek. And I'll have a link to that on our blog as well. Just one last statement. Actually, we might do astrotheology next week as well. I did not even get to talk about a bunch of stuff I wanted to. You know, there's lots of contradictions, particularly in the Bible. You know, thou shalt not kill. But then, you know, I think it was the book of Matthew says, I do not come in, or attributes to Jesus saying, I do not come in peace, I bring the sword, you know. And that I think a big part of why the ruling classes construct religion the way they do is to justify the ability for families to let their children go and go off to war and fight the battles that they want fought, because that's the one pervasive thing that you see. It's just like, hey, if it's good enough for God to sacrifice his own son, his only begotten son, and that son dies for the transgressions of others, you know, it's okay for the individual family to do the same thing. And that's what I think the core or part of this is about, and that is war and the continuing battle for resources, control, and that oftentimes religion is just, it's put out there because that's what people can grasp, that's what they can adhere to, they can spread the Bible, but what we're, it's the hidden knowledge is really what we're after. And so in order to find out what that hidden knowledge is, you can't go to mainstream sources. You have to go around the front, around the back, up through the middle, on the sides, and every other way you can, because the information is out there. You just have to want to get it. And most people don't want the truth. They would rather believe in a comfortable lie than in a comfortable truth. And so that will leave the show with that. They are closing song. We'll be back next week. Check out the Facebook. Check out on Facebook and hopefully YouTube pretty soon. And this will repeat.
Sweet.
Keep an eye out after that.
David Bowie's going to leave us a message and let us know that God knows that he's good.
All right. Thanks for listening. We'll talk to you next week.
Walking through the counters of a national concern, and a cash machine was spitting by my shoulder, and I saw the multitude of faces, honest, rich and clean, as the merchandise exchanged and money bought, and a woman hot with worry, slyly slipped a tin of a stewing steak into the paper bag at her side. And her face was white with fear in case her actions were absurd. So she closed her eyes to keep her conscience blind. Crying, God knows I'm good. God knows I'm good. God knows I'm good. God may look the other way today. God knows I'm good. God knows I'm good. God knows I'm good. God may look the other way today. She moved toward the exit, clutching tightly at her paper bag. Perspiration trickled down her forehead, and her heart had leapt inside her as a hand laid on her shoulder. She was